Both of them. I'll be damned. You just haven't experienced anything until you have glasses, hearing aids.
And then a mask.
Yeah. And a mask. It's just... I was so thrilled when I discovered that if you actually lift the mask from the top, it generally comes apart. But, of course, not today when I'm standing here. Welcome, everyone. Good morning to everyone. Good morning to everyone on Zoom and YouTube. We're very pleased to see everybody today, and I'm looking forward to our speaker that we have from UCF this morning. Be sure, either on Zoom or YouTube or in the present, that you turn your devices down if you haven't already. And if everybody is on board, we'll begin with our committee moments. I know that Karen Cowden will be coming up, and she'll talk to us about Zoom participation.
Good morning, Margie from membership. We are having our second membership pathway meeting today after service, 11:45, to the right in the library. Normally for visitors, the way it goes is you would go to UU 101 first and then to the membership pathway meeting in that order. But if you're a visitor and you want to come to this one, come on back and hear a little bit more about it. We'll have sandwiches and drinks back there. Thanks.
Hi, David McElroy with the men's group. We are still Zooming our men's group, men's support group, and that's tomorrow night at 7 o'clock. If you are interested in and you haven't come or want to know about it, come and see me afterwards. We usually meet about an hour and 10 minutes, something like that. So again, tomorrow night at 7 on Zoom.
Good morning. Nice to see so many friendly faces here and through our many platforms. So I am Karen. I'm part of the Reopening Task Force Committee, and we have heard some concerns from others who aren't comfortable at this point coming back about the Zoom experience and that they enjoyed that. So we're piloting that at UUF. We're a diverse population and we like to offer diverse solutions. So if you want to later on come by, you can wave to the camera that's right there in that sunflower laptop. We have two, maybe three participants checking us out via there. We also are streaming on YouTube and Facebook. So we will let you know how today goes, and thank you again to all that made it happen. So.
Good morning. Excuse me. Good morning. On behalf of the A Welcome for Tracy Task Force, we're encouraging everybody who would like to write a little note to Tracy in welcome. We're going to prepare a basket for her, and in that basket will be a journal that will contain these notes. If you would, rather than writing a note, send it via email. The time for mailing a card has passed, unfortunately, but if by some magic you can go get a card and come back today before I leave. I'm delivering all this stuff to Happy, who is going to be preparing this journal for Tracy. It's just words of welcome, and everybody is invited to participate if they would like to. Thank you.
And then for opening words, those of you that have looked at connections or notable news are aware that our speaker today will be talking about Charles Darwin, and these opening words relate to Charles Darwin. It is always fascinating to read about the rule breakers. Almost daily we read about the tech giants, Sundar Pichai, Google, Mark Zuckerberg, Facebook, Tim Cook, Apple, Jeff Bezos, Amazon, and lest we forget Elon Musk, Tesla. And of course, the scientists who have blazed the trails, Marie Curie, Charles Darwin, and Albert Einstein, among others. Who will remember these names 50 years from now? Maybe only Einstein and Darwin. Today we will learn more about Charles Darwin, whose accomplishments in science, the theory of natural selection, in the 19th century put him on a plateau of remembrance for the ages. And now for our opening music. This is one that's new to me also, so I think it'll be new to everyone. And now for the lighting of the chalice. Frequently, when we're all together, we have our children with us, and our children assist us in that, but we're operating separately. If you will join me in the warmth of love, we gather to seek, to sustain, and to share. And we also take this moment for our affirmation to make our statements for what we believe. And so please join with me. Love is the spirit of this church, and service is its gift. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek truth and love, and help one another. And so at this time, I'd like to let everyone know who is here that we have many different speakers on many different occasions. We're also excited to talk about the fact that we now have a part-time minister, and so we'll have they will be inserting what they have to say on various topics over the weeks. But our topics vary greatly, and so we invite you to come back if you're visiting and get a sense that we're all about. You need to come more than once, and we hope that you will. For joys and concerns, we invite everybody who has a joy to share or a concern that is germane to our church and your needs. Please come forward at this time.
Ray Brammer Wilson here. I have a joy and concern. The joy is, as many of you know, I have 12 grandchildren. Today is the birthday of the youngest. She's 6 years old today, and she's mighty, boy. And my concern is my sister-in-law is back in the hospital. She keeps falling, having strokes, all of that. So keep her in your thoughts.
Margie Espaillat, my joy is next week this time, Luke and I are going to be on our honeymoon.
Hi, I'm Jill Vita. As many of you know, I'm a critical care nurse, and it's been a really rough couple months for me. But I'm really happy to be here, and I'm really glad that you guys are still here.
My name is Anne, and I have a joy, or a couple of joys, and a concern. So my joy is that we successfully deposited two of our kids at UF. So it's going okay. It's very difficult. College is so different now than when I went 30 plus years ago. And in the midst of COVID, it's even weirder. So I'm just keeping them in my thoughts. And also Maddie, our third one started at Seminole State this week. So far so good. And she got her license. So my concern, I'm getting a concern on behalf of Martha. Her good friend called her Friday and said she was having symptoms of COVID. Martha drove her to the emergency room, and fortunately she was not admitted, but she's home resting and hopefully recovering, so just keep her in your thoughts.
Well, my granddaughter is celebrating her birthday today, too, and I told her maybe she could stream, so I hope she's watching. Happy birthday, Rachel!
Hello, Chloe Hatfield. I have two joys. One is that this Thursday I have an interview to be a preschool teacher at the Science Center, which is something I'm looking very forward to. I've loved the Science Center ever since I was a kid, and being the daughter of a science teacher, it'd be really cool to be a preschool teacher at the Science Center. So, and then my second one is that Friday, I'm trying to get all my dates right. Friday, I went in for a procedure. I had this procedure done before, and the previous time I had a very bad experience with it, so I was very nervous to have it done again. It went fantastic. I didn't have any negative things, and so that was one of my joys. Like, I was just a nervous wreck, and everything went great.
Hello, I'm Marcia Fudon, and on Wednesday it's going to be 2 years that Bernard passed away, 2 years already. And I'm managing, and my balance is not good, but my head is still working. So sort of I'm managing. It's good to be here.
Thank you.
I have a joy also. Some of you may be familiar with this because I'm putting together a program that has been distributed to many people via Sarah and the Covenant groups. And so some may know about this. But it's a discussion of the transitions in our life, the passages. And whether you're 20s, early adulthood, 30s, your 40s, your 50s, there are moments in your life and makeups in your personality that you find that you have to leave behind and make adjustments as you move forward. And the memories of these will stay with you, but you have to move forward. These all comes from some books that were written in the mid-70s and the mid-90s by Gail Sheehy. And so I've invited people to come out and give us what was an important point in your transition from one point to another in your life. And we already have four, I'm pleased to say, so I think we can put together a service based on that. But that doesn't mean that we can't do this more than once or do it quarterly or something. I've talked to some of you individually, and you have some amazing things that have happened to you at certain points in your 20s, your 30s, or your 40s. And so I invite others to let me know when you'll be available, and we can perhaps do that more. I think our congregation loves to know how our congregation's doing. And now a time for the ages with Judith and Roberta.
So Roberta is going to help me this morning. Good morning, everybody. Roberta is going to help me this morning. As you probably know, Roberta is an artist and a writer and a storyteller, and she wrote a book several years back, long before I got here, called The Rainbow Making Machine. The subject came up today, came up this week, we make mistakes sometimes. What do we do when we get it wrong is my subject matter this week. And while Roberta's book focuses also on the seventh principle, which is the interdependent web of existence of which we're all a part, which means what we do in this world makes a difference, how we take care of the earth matters. This story also reflects our fifth principle, honoring our right of conscience, our right to speak up. And our sixth principle, the goal of world community, that we need to work together. But it also speaks to coming to terms with mistakes or getting it wrong, and how we learn and deal with it and correct ourselves. So listen to Roberta's story. The pictures will be up here, and hopefully we'll move it along properly.
Good morning. Okay, I guess I'll just get started. Deep in the forest, beneath the roots of the oak tree, live a group of fairies, and their names are tiger lily, meadow grass, violet, rose, daffodil, and camellia. It was summer, and it was hot, but the thick green foliage on the trees shaded the forest floor and kept it comfortable. It was on this particular day that Tiger Lily picked up her bucket and went down to the river to get some water. But she saw that the water had turned black, and she had to walk along the banks of the river all the way to Peppermint Lake before she found clean water. And when she got back, she told the other fairies what had happened. And Rose said, "Well, you know, I went to the meadow today to get some honey for our bread. But when I got there, I saw that the hive had been knocked down and all the bees were gone. And then I noticed that a lot of the flowers and berries had already been picked and most of the leaves were gone on the trees. And I found out for some of the other forest creatures that a group of elves had moved to Rock Cave upriver and set up a rainbow-making machine. And they were using the flowers, the berries, and the leaves for the colors of their rainbow. Oh, That's why I see so many rainbows, said Camellia. I was wondering why, because I thought you only see rainbows after a rainstorm. Oh, I love the new look in the forest, said Violet. Everything is so colorful. Yes, said Rose, but it's ruining our forest. We have to go further away to get water, and if the elves keep making rainbows, we're going to have trouble finding food. Daffodil said, you know, there's a meeting in the sacred circle tonight. It might be about the rainbows. We should go. And so they went to the sacred circle that night. Oh, there were a lot of inhabitants from the forest there, and everybody was talking at once. Brown Nobby was saying, oh, I love the colors of the rainbow. And Rufus the Owl was saying, I'm in a really bad mood. I can't find any food. The women, the ladies, the mother, the maiden, and the wise old one told everybody to quiet down. They'd all get to turn to talk one at a time. And then they would go to the elves the next day and tell them what they thought and ask them, why are you here? Why are you making so many rainbows? Everybody come back tomorrow night, they said, and we'll tell you what they said. Well, the inhabitants came back the next night, and the mother came forward and looked a little sad. She said, when we tried to talk to the elves, they wouldn't listen to us. All they would say is, they've heard nothing but good comments about the rainbows, and they're going to continue to make them until the whole forest is full of their color. After that, everybody that lived in the forest had to walk further and further away to find clean water. And they all decided that they would search for food during the day, and they would meet at the sacred circle that night and share so that nobody would go hungry. One night, when they were sharing what little bit of food they found, a family of elves came by. They looked around at everybody and they said, we're hungry. Where do you go to find your food? This is the only food we could find today, said the maiden, and we're sharing. Well, you know, our children are getting tummy aches, and we think it's from drinking the water. Are any of you getting tummy aches? And then the mother stepped forward and said, you know, before you came here and set up your rainbow-making machine, the water was always clear and tasty. And there was plenty of food for all, even enough to store for the winter when food would be harder to find. Oh, we know the rainbows are beautiful, but you're ruining our forest by making so many. The elves looked around at everybody. And then they looked at each other, and they turned and they walked away without saying a word. The next day, the forest creatures saw that the rainbow machine had been turned off, and the elves had simply disappeared. They thought they were gone forever. They knew it would be hard to get through the next few seasons, but they were going to have to do the best they could. But then, a couple of weeks later, just as silently and as suddenly as the elves disappeared, they came back, and as they walked through the forest, they saw that they were pushing wheelbarrows and pulling carts, and the wheelbarrows had sacks full of food, and the carts had new fruit-bearing bushes. And as they went through the forest, they said, come to the meadow if you're hungry. We have food for all. And when the fairies got to the meadow, they saw that the elves were already digging holes and planting the new trees, and people were helping themselves to food. Yeah, well, all the critters were helping themselves to food. And they said, you know, we came to this forest to live because we thought it was so beautiful. We just thought we'd make it more beautiful with our rainbows. We didn't realize that we were ruining the forest by making so many. We want to stay here, and that's why we brought you some food and new bushes. Well, word spread through the forest about the changed elves. And that night, there was a big celebration in the sacred circle, welcoming them back. And at that celebration, they said, you know, we've turned off our rainbow-making machine, but we haven't taken it down, because maybe after a rain or on a dreary day, you may wish to see a rainbow. And then we can turn it on and make one or two. but not enough to upset the whole forest. And then after that, everybody enjoyed the rest of the lazy days of summer.
Thank you so much, Roberta. At this point, it is our interlude and our offering. We are making contributions to various organizations, as you can see up there, made by our Social and Justice Committee. And we also have beautiful music to accompany this, and we invite everyone to come forward and to make a contribution, if you will, and I will do the same. Our speaker today, Dr. Peter Sinelli, is a senior lecturer of anthropology at the University of Central Florida. His research interests include West Indian prehistory, migration and island colonization theory, settlement patterns and ecological adaptation, archaeological ceramics, physical anthropology, and maritime and underwater archaeology. Dr. Sinelli has been at UCF since 2005 and teaches a wide variety of archaeology and physical anthropology courses. Today, we're going to learn, get some insight into Charles Darwin. Peter?
Thank you, and thank you for the opportunity to be with you today.
I always enjoy coming out and talking to different groups, members of the public, about a wide variety of different topics. And today is one of my favorites. I'm a big fan of Darwin's, not just because of what I do, but because of how he truly represents, I think, a seminal moment in human scientific understanding about the natural world. And he was as controversial in his day as anybody could be. And of course, we know that, you know, the controversies surrounding Charles Darwin, you know, still rage in some circles today. But fortunately, he was able to live long enough to see his ideas about natural selection and how this drove species change and the evolution of new species over time. He lived long enough to see that enjoy universal acceptance within the scientific community, you know, such as it was in 1882 when he passed away. And today, of course, the idea of natural selection and evolution by that means is the underpinning foundational basis for everything from medicine to biology to climate science. The environment, the role that it plays, the process of natural selection. So today, I'm not going to give you a lecture on natural selection. If you want to hear about that, I will be discussing that in my classes in about 2 weeks after Labor Day. So feel free to stop in, and I can torment you with natural selection like I torment all of my undergrads. Today, what I thought would be a good discussion would be to talk more about Charles Darwin the man and how Darwin the person was able to develop these kinds of ideas facing the kind of challenges that we all face. No life is without hurdles. And Darwin, as much as he is revered within the scientific community, he was a dude like everybody else, and he put his pants on one leg at a time. And he had ups and he had downs and he had family problems and he had health issues and he had a whole variety of other challenges that are just common parts of life, that, you know, things that everybody has to deal with at one point or another. Yet he was able to overcome that and make the contributions he was able to make. So we're going to talk a little bit about Darwin the man today, and hopefully give you a better idea for who this person was, what kinds of challenges he faced, how he overcame those, and just take a look at Darwin from a little bit of a different perspective, not just Darwin the scientist, but Darwin the person. Oh, there it is. Now what I do. Perfect. So here we have, of course, Charles. Now, when I say Darwin, the image that pops into everyone's head is Darwin, the really, really old guy with the long beard and the frumpy look on his face like he's in pain. He was in pain. He had very serious health issues for really the last two-thirds of his life. And the dude just looked miserable, right? So I would appreciate it if when, you know, many years from now they have pictures of me. It's not me when I have one foot in the grave. It's me when I'm in my early 20s and I had a full head of hair and I was in great shape and all those things. This is Darwin's graduation picture when he was in his early 20s, right before he went on the Beagle. A handsome guy, and I'm sure that he would appreciate it if everybody remembered him for that. We're going to talk about Darwin's education and a little bit about the trip on the Beagle, and then we'll talk about Darwin and the challenges he faced as he was working to reconcile what he observed in the Galapagos with these finches and the idea of natural selection and how he was able to reconcile that with everything else he was taught and believed and learned about. Darwin, as many people know, was wealthy. He was born into wealth on both sides of his family, wealth and success and a long intellectual tradition. On the Darwin side, his grandfather Erasmus was one of the leading intellectuals of the Georgian era in Great Britain. He was a poet, he was a naturalist, and it was actually Erasmus who was the first Darwin to write about a common origin for life and how life on the planet is related to a single ancestor and evolved and changed over time. That wasn't Charles Darwin's idea, this notion of species change over time. We remember Charles Darwin because he was the first guy to come up with how it really worked. He was the first person to figure out the process. He wasn't the first person to ask the question. People have asked that since at least his grandfather. On his mother's side, his mother was a Wedgwood. Josiah Wedgwood was a potter in the 18th century in Great Britain and had contracts, royal decrees from many of the royal houses of Europe, including Great Britain, to make their ceramics. So if you were to go over to the Queen's and have tea, it would very likely have been on Wedgwood's designs. Wedgwood was really one of the first tycoons of the Industrial Revolution in Great Britain. He recognized the power of this new steam technology and was indeed the first person to put a steam engine in a factory anywhere in the world. He automated his pottery making process so that he could mass produce them, sell them at a cheaper rate to just regular folks, and became fantastically wealthy as a result of that. His wife also was a Wedgwood. And here's Darwin's family tree. It's not entirely complete, but here we have Charles, his mother, daughter of Josiah Wedgwood II, his uncle, father of his wife. Yes, they were first cousins. This was common during this era, particularly amongst the British upper class. It was a great way to keep the money in the family if you didn't marry outside of the family. Darwin and his cousin slash wife Emma lived together very happily for many, many years. They had nine children, six of whom made it close to adulthood, and lived happily ever after. Darwin and Emma were very close. Darwin, Charles, was a doting father, very, very dedicated to his children, and as we're going to see, The untimely death of one of his daughters actually played a role in his decision to ultimately publish what he knew about natural selection. So his family was very important to him and plays an important role in this entire process. Darwin was never a great student. He grew up, of course, on many estates and acres. There was lots of money, lots of land owned on both sides of his family. And Charles's favorite thing to do would be to wake up in the morning, throw on his boots, grab his gun, and go out bird hunting on the family's many acres. He was an accomplished horseman. He loved to be outside, stomping around in the bushes, collecting plants and animals. This was where he felt most confident. He was kind of shy and retiring, just personality-wise. He also had a stutter when he was younger. So he wasn't terribly comfortable in the classrooms of the era where you would have to learn these foreign languages and do recitations and things like that. He wasn't comfortable with that, and he wasn't a very good student. He did go to medical school at the age of 16. His father sent him to the University of Edinburgh because he wanted to make sure that his son didn't just spend all of his days hunting, but actually did something constructive. Medicine was kind of the family business. His father Thomas was a doctor. His grandfather Erasmus, by trade, was a doctor. So this was kind of the family business. Darwin went there, had watched them conduct surgeries before anesthesia in those big classrooms where they have the hole in the floor, right, with the operating room under it, and then they had all the, like in the old movies you've seen. So Darwin would have to watch them cut into people to perform surgery without anesthesia. He'd turn green, barf in his hat, and leave the classroom. Didn't have the constitution to do it. Finally, his father said, you know, this isn't going to work for you, son, but you got to do something constructive. Why don't you go study to be a minister? He transferred from the University of Edinburgh to Cambridge and studied theology. At Cambridge, he was also able to explore some of the natural sciences to learn more about the natural world that had always been the source of greatest joy for him. So like many college students, he went to school, he had a major, but he also was able to enjoy the freedom to take classes in other topics that he found interesting. And it was through these natural history classes that he took and natural scientific classes that he took that he made the contacts with the professors that put him in touch with the Royal Navy expedition to go on the Beagle. Now, Darwin was a theology major. The only degree the guy ever got was a Bachelor of Arts with a focus in theology. It was Darwin's goal to become an Anglican minister. That was his career path. He went on the Beagle not because he had some grand designs about proving natural selection. He went on the Beagle because he was 23 years old and he wanted adventure. It was his gap year. More than a year, the Beagle cruise was 4.5 years. But the expectation was, okay, Charles, you can go on this trip, you can ride around different continents on horseback, you can look at plants and animals, you can shoot things, you can have your adventure, you'll come back here, you'll be ordained, you'll get married, you'll settle down and live a proper, civilized, gentlemanly life. And this was what he had planned to do when he left. The Beagle left in 1831. Darwin's job as naturalist was to just kind of go into the interior as the Beagle was. The Beagle was a mapping mission. Their job was to sail around different places, different ports all around the world, and create charts, nautical charts, for the British Navy. That's what they were supposed to do. So it wasn't really a warship. It was more of a survey ship. And while they're going back and forth in these, in a grid pattern in some harbor someplace in South America, taking depths and trying to see where the obstacles are, put all this stuff on their charts, right? Well, you know, Darwin didn't really have a lot to do. His job was to take a launch onto the shore with his horses and a couple of guys and their guns and go into the wilderness and see what resources and plants and animals there were. So his mission was kind of ancillary to what the primary mission of the Beagle was, but it was still sanctioned by the Crown because it was part of, you know, their overall effort to better understand the natural history of different places and also see if there were any commercially exploitable resources that were available. So Darwin had studied geology of the day. The father of geology, Charles Lyell, who was a generation older than Darwin, but ultimately would become a mentor and one of his best friends in scientific sounding boards. Darwin took Lyell's books on the principles of geology with him, with the idea that, you know, I'll know if there are any good mineral resources when I see it, and here's how I can learn those things. So these were the kinds of things that Darwin's job entailed. He wasn't really doing any analysis on the Beagle. The Beagle could fit in a room maybe twice this size, so he didn't have the space for it. He would stomp around in the bushes, collect his specimens, and then when the Beagle would depart and was at sea, he would be responsible for doing the taxidermy and pickling things and pressing plants, crating all of these things up so that the next time they got to port, he could have them shipped back to Great Britain to one of his natural history professor friends who was storing them for him in London. Now, Darwin collected a bunch of stuff and kept catalogs of it and things like that. He didn't do any analysis while he was out at sea. He didn't have the time, he didn't have the space. It wasn't until after he returned in the mid to late 1830s, he got back in October of 1836, it wasn't until then that Darwin starts opening up some of these crates and going through his notes as he's doing some of the analysis and cataloging. And this is when the gears start turning. I see these birds that I found in the Galapagos Islands. This is a picture of Darwin's finches hand-tagged with notes in Darwin's own hand. Why is it that these things all have different beaks? Well, I found the one that has the beak that is used to crack nuts and seeds. I found that one living in the part of the Galapagos Islands that has lots of nuts and seeds. I find this one that has the beak that is used to catch insects in the wetter areas of the Galapagos where there's lots of insects. I find this one that uses its beak shape to root around in the leaf litter of the forest floor in, guess where? A forest floor where there is a floor with lots of leaf litter in it. And it's when he looks at these and he starts putting two and two together, well, a bird with this beak eats this. Looks at his notes, well, wow, that's where I found it. Bird with his beak eats that. Well, wow, that's where I found it. All these things look very similar. Clearly, they're related. Why is it that their beaks changed over time? What caused this process? This, of course, as we all know, Darwin's finches, the aha moment that Darwin has. when he sees this phenomenon and really tries to figure it out. We think Darwin, we think Galapagos, we think finches. He was only there for 5 weeks. He collected, you know, a few dozen specimens of finches. But that was really what got his gears turning. This is a great picture of all the different kinds of finches with the different kinds of beaks that were identified by Darwin and were instrumental to his at least identification of this phenomenon of change over time. Like I said, we're not going to go through the whole idea about natural selection. I have a whole different lecture to torture people with about that. But you know, how can you have a talk with Darwin if you don't talk about finches? Darwin spent the late 1830s and early 1840s conducting research, including breeding domestic animals. He wrote literally hundreds of letters to any scientist that he could think of that might be able to help him understand this, and was able to put together a pretty cogent idea over that, you know, 5 to 6 year period after he got back as to how exactly this process worked out. He was busy doing other things as well. His notebooks from the voyage of the Beagle, which was kind of like a travel adventure story, he published that when he got home and received quite a bit of acclaim for it. The book sold very well commercially. The public snapped it up because it was an exciting adventure story. But Darwin also revealed that he, like other Darwins in the past, most notably his grandfather, had a knack for this sort of naturalist thing. So it was really the publication of his notebooks from the Beagle that established Darwin as an up-and-comer in the scientific community. This is like the next generation of Darwins that's going to be able to answer some interesting questions for us. This guy is cut from the same cloth as his grandfather. A lot of people don't really realize that Darwin published his book, and this was the first one that was he became famous for. And he did that in the 1830s after he got back from his voyage on the Beagle. There we go. So in the early 1840s, Darwin, feeling that he had kind of worked things out in his head about how natural selection operated, wrote two manuscripts, wrote basically two rough drafts for his book. But then he just sat on this idea. And here it is where Darwin the person, it's important to understand Darwin the person in order to understand the process by which he ultimately comes to reveal to the world his thoughts about natural selection. Remember, Darwin was from an upper crust blue blood British society. And ideas of what were proper included adherence to the teachings of the Church of England, which at that time, of course, believed in, you know, like most religions, believed in fixity of the species, the creation event at a fixed point in time in the not too terribly distant past, 6,000 years ago. Everything was created by God as described in the book of Genesis. Darwin's wife, a Wedgwood, daughter of Josiah, or granddaughter of Josiah, daughter of Josiah II, who took over the business from his father when his father passed away, could not find a more appropriate archetype for Victorian propriety than Darwin's wife. She was very religious. She was also very concerned with what other people might say from within their social circle about her husband and his ridiculous ideas that are completely at odds with everything that proper society is talking about. So Darwin, like men had for thousands of years before, like men do today, like men will 1,000 years from now, he didn't want to make the wife mad, so he didn't push it. And he said, "Yes, dear." And one of the big reasons that he just sat on this was because he didn't want to make her any more unhappy than she already was with what he was working on. Darwin also, the Darwins had their particular social status as well. And he didn't want to be ostracized within his particular community either. He felt his wife's concerns about that. So the very conservative social circles in which the Darwins ran certainly looked upon these crazy ideas with disapproval, and Darwin didn't want to be ostracized any more than anybody else would have. Darwin turns his attentions to, believe it or not, barnacles, and becomes the global authority on that particular little crustacean that affixes itself to piers and bolt holes. Believe it or not, he wins his first National Scientific Award for his work on barnacles. In 1853, he is admitted to the Royal Society and wins the medal for his pioneering work on this very exciting and exotic creature. He is recognized as the global authority on barnacles for anybody who, I guess, has a barnacle-related question. I'm not sure how busy he was about that, but if you needed something about barnacles, Darwin was the guy you went and talked to. It's also during this period in the 1840s and 1850s that Darwin, and I apologize for this, it's giving me a little bit of sass. It is during this period that Darwin is suffering from a variety of different medical issues, some of which literally render him bedridden for months. It remains somewhat unclear as to what exactly he had. There were not any concise diagnoses during the period. People think that he may have contracted a tropical disease that would flare up from time to time. They think he may have had an intestinal disorder or something like Crohn's disease, something like that perhaps. He definitely suffered from what we would now call migraines. And he definitely suffered from what we would now call clinical depression as well. Darwin, during this period, had his ups and downs. And we think of Darwin as this paragon, almost invulnerable, right? But Darwin, like I said, was a guy like anybody else. And he had his challenges, and he had his health issues. He had his family problems. He had his social problems. He was rich, and so was his wife. So one thing he was able to not worry too much about was money. But he was concerned about his standing within the scientific and social communities. He had a lot of the same anxieties that just any normal person has, including exacerbated in many cases by the problems that he had with his digestive tract and his GI system. This is a letter to his one of his sounding boards, his scientific friends, Joseph Hooker. Indeed, all this winter I've been bad enough with dreadful vomiting every week, and my nervous system began to be affected so that my hands trembled and head was often swimming. I was not able to do anything one day out of three and was altogether too dispirited to write to you or to do anything but what I was compelled. I thought I was rapidly going the way of all flesh. This was typical for him. He would have these flare-ups and they would really knock him for a loop. So it was difficult for him to focus himself long-term on the project in addition to all of the other concerns that he had. In 1851, his favorite daughter, Anne, passed away. And he writes to his cousin, "I do not suppose you will have heard of our bitter and cruel loss. Poor dear little Annie, she was my favorite child. Her cordiality, openness, buoyant joyousness, and strong affection made her most lovable. Poor dear little soul. Well, it is all over." So facing the loss of a child, which of course is the greatest trauma that any parent can face, Darwin kind of shuts down for a while. He kind of shuts down for a while in the early 1850s. It also causes in Darwin a bit of a crisis of faith. How could a God who is all-loving and all-caring take away my poor, sweet child? I think that we can understand where he's coming from in that kind of a situation. Darwin really is kind of rudderless for much of the 1850s, at least the early 1850s, and indeed writes to the same cousin upon the death of their child, his niece, 2 years later, We both most truly sympathize with you and Mrs. Fox. We too lost, as you may remember not very long ago, a most dear child of whom I can hardly let bear to think tranquilly. This is more than 2 years after the death of Anne, and you can see that the wounds are still fresh. In 1856, Darwin is encouraged by Charles Lyell, his geology friend, and others. Ironically enough, the story goes that they kind of had an intervention with Darwin over billiards and brandies at someone's house, where they're like, you know, Charles, you've been talking about this natural selection stuff. You have been boring us for 15 years with this nonsense, okay? And it's time to do your business or get off the pot. So you need to publish it or you need to leave us alone because we're kind of tired of it. All right? And so Lyell just basically throws down the gauntlet. And Darwin writes about this to Joe Hooker. Had a good talk with Lyell about my species work, and he urges me strongly to publish something. Publish something. You've been working on this for 18 years, Chuck. It's time to do something, right? This is a picture of Darwin from 1855. In 1858, he's kind of half-heartedly doing what Lyell told him to do and his buddies. He's like, all right, you know, I'll start working on it. He pulls out those manuscripts he'd written 15 years ago at this point, kind of dusts them off and has some more ideas. And he figures he's about halfway done with his book when he gets a letter from a researcher named Alfred Russel Wallace, who you may have heard of. Wallace was a Brit. He also worked... as a naturalist, Wallace was a professional collector, however, not like Darwin, who did it kind of avocationally. Wallace hired himself out to universities and museums in order to go around the world collecting animals and plants for scientific purposes. It was in Malaysia when he looked at a group of beetles. Those beetles were, for Wallace, what the finches were for Darwin. And he came up with the idea of natural selection completely independently of Darwin. They never really talked about it. Wallace writes a letter to Darwin and says, hey, you know, I kind of heard it from the grapevine that, you know, you're interested in this stuff too. Here's what I think. Sends it to Darwin. Darwin reads this and about loses his lunch. And he says to Charles Lyell, his buddy, your words have come true with a vengeance, because Lyell's like, if you don't publish this, somebody's going to. Your words come true with a vengeance. I never saw a more striking coincidence. So all my originality, whatever it may amount to, will be smashed. Oh my God, I'm going to get scooped. And it's been 18 years I've been working on this. It will be a cold day in hell before I let anybody else get credit for my work. So Darwin, because he's a Darwin, he's rich, he's now really motivated, he can lock himself in his study and he can work on this thing. Wallace is just a working stiff, right? He's got to punch a clock. He's got to go still do his research. Wallace doesn't have the time or the resources that Darwin does to lock himself in and dedicate himself to this full time. Plus, Darwin has a big head start with all the other work he's done. Darwin's able to get his book out first. If Wallace just never had sent that letter, it's quite possible that Darwin would have sat on it for the rest of his life. And Wallace would be the guy on my socks. And it wouldn't be finches, it would be beetles. Darwin finishes his abstract, which was what he called Origins, turned out to be about a 500-page abstract, so you'd hate to think of what he would have written if he would have written a full book, right? And this, of course, is Origins. He finishes it in the spring of 1859 and writes to Lyell and says, hey, tell me what you think. I think I'm in pretty good shape. He gets some suggestions for publishers. He's able to work that out. Everybody in the scientific community is highly anticipating this because, remember, Darwin's been talking about it for going on 2 decades now. It finally is published in, oh, this is a fun little aside here. So Darwin had this picture taken shortly before the book was published, and he hated it. He absolutely hated this picture. And so he writes Hooker, his buddy, for heaven's sake, oblige me and burn that now hanging up in your room. It makes me look atrociously wicked. The book, of course, is published in 1859, 162 years ago this November. The first edition was 1,250 copies. It was oversubscribed, never even hit the bookshore shelves. It was oversubscribed by 250 copies. So even before this thing made it to print, Darwin was already at work on a second edition. There were six editions that appeared over his lifetime. This book, 162 years later, has never been out of print. And you can go on Amazon and find any number of copies. I recommend the first edition because that's the purest Darwin. It doesn't have everything in it that we associate with natural selection because he did, of course, continue to add to it for the next 20 years. But the first one is pure Darwin, and I recommend the first edition. If I win the Powerball, I'm going to buy a first edition. They go for about $800,000 at auction. Yeah. So, yeah, I kind of have to win the lottery for that. I do work at UCF. And this, of course, is, you know, if I say Darwin, this is the image that we get. This is one of the last formal portraits taken of Charles Darwin. And he looks like he's in pain. And indeed, he was. And he's wearing the shawl to try to stay warm. Darwin was a person just like the rest of us. He didn't have any designs on changing the world. He was afforded wonderful opportunities because of who he was and who his family was. But he really made the most of these and was able to, through great personal strength and intellect and the support of his family, overcome the kinds of challenges that probably would have sent a lesser man to an early grave. We remember Charles Darwin for natural selection, but it's important to also remember Charles Darwin was a person, just like you and me. And I think the story of Darwin is inspirational, not just because of what he was able to provide us with this idea of evolution by means of natural selection, but the notion of perseverance against adversity, the notion that any choice we make in life is not permanent. And there are paths that we have to follow, even though it may not be the path that we originally set out upon. So I think the idea of flexibility, of perseverance, of answering the call and bearing with life throughout all of the different challenges that we will inevitably face. I think that these are lessons we can all take from Charles Darwin, even if we don't come up with something that ultimately turns into a theory that literally changes the scientific world. I think that there's lots in his life that we all can take to heart. Thank you very much for your time. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Doctor. We're going to conclude our service, and then if you have some moment, if you can stay with us, there may be some questions for you.
I would be happy to, yes.
Great. If you will join with me, we extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again. This can be something else that we can talk to the good doctor about. Artificial intelligence, some say, is opening the door for the types of genetic engineering breakthroughs that may ultimately allow us to evolve our offspring in unprecedented ways. So perhaps Darwin's theory of natural selection will soon take a new path.
see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? They're really saying, I love you. I hear babies cry, I watch them grow. Like much more than I never knew. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Yes, I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
After the service now with coffee, the Memorial Garden will be open, and we have a chance perhaps to ask some questions of the good doctor. So we can conclude now. I also wish to say to you that the program that we're putting together called Passages, I have copies of that if anybody wants, has not seen these copies and wants to give some thought to participating with us in the future on that. I wish everyone a good day.